Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Mr. Ian Campbell and Mr. Bill Cavanagh, the keepers. Hello and welcome to Talkin' Tunes. I am your host, Frank Walsh. Thanks for tuning in today, and we hope that you enjoyed our new opening, and we're going to be trying some new and exciting things with the show going forward. But you had just listened to these two gentlemen here, Mr. Ian Campbell and Mr. Bill Cavanagh, known as the Keepers. They have been around playing together for about 10 years. They play a combination of original songs and some covers, and you are going to be in for a treat because they're going to come back in a little while and play some more music. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you, Ian, Bill. Thanks for coming on, boys.
Thanks for having us,
thanks
my man.
Thanks for coming on.
My pleasure.
It's a blast.
Now, Ian, you know, you're a repeat offender. You were here a while ago with
Don't
a group
tell my
called,
probation officer, yeah.
Yeah, a fervent group. Yeah. They let you out on probation.
That's correct, yeah. About a year ago today, yeah.
Just about, yeah. And you were here with Fervent Groove.
I was, fantastic band out of the South Shore with Hannes Schneider and Greg Miller, two of my heroes on the music scene, so it was a real pleasure to play with them for several gigs, including a real good gig at the Greasy Luck with Danny Klein's band. That was just...
We were there for that.
Yeah,
that was one of my lifetime memories I'm going to cherish forever. So Hannes, if you're in the building, thank you. That was great.
Hannes is in the building.
Yeah, and then we got to do the gig at the Raynham Park there.
We filmed that.
With the immensely talented Tyler Morris.
Yes.
And let me tell you, I wanted to go home. as soon as I saw him play, I'm like, I'm leaving. But we got through it, and we put on a great show. So yeah. That was great.
But you kind of moved on a little bit, you know? Why don't you talk a little bit about you two playing and what you guys have been up to, and then we'll get to you in a second, Bill.
Sure. Actually, it's kind of a funny story. We met online. Not like that.
No.
No, but
Match.com?
No,
Plenty of Fish?
There's a site called South Shore Muse.
Yes.
Yes.
And Bill had posted an ad looking for a singer, guitarist, and I think the age cutoff.
To start a duo.
The age cutoff was, I think, 35, and I was slightly over that at the time.
You lied to me.
I lied to get the gig. and we got together, and we started playing, and we found out we both have a love for fishing.
Really?
So we spent more time fishing than playing, but then we'd play more, and then in the spring we'd fish, and then in the summer we'd play, and so we decided to call the band The Keepers, because if any of you out there fish, you know, the Keepers are a big striper. So
there you go.
And we started writing songs about fishing. And
Well, you anticipated one of my questions. I was going to say, how'd you come up with the names?
But I like that. I read your mind.
You answered that.
We're talking about the school.
Reading my mind, that's like looking at an empty glass, I tell you. But go ahead.
So my quick elevator pitch is I played in some bands throughout high school. I remember Hans from high school.
Yep.
We had, I won't say competing bands, but complementary bands. We used to do gigs at the Ranch House. You all remember the Ranch House?
Sure.
And then played in Boston with a band called the Modern Plaids. Mm-hmm. We met at UMass, and we won the Battle of the Bands there. And so we had some opening slots with the Smithereens and the Fools and some the Tubes.
Couldn't play with any good bands, huh?
No. John Cafferty and the Beaver Brown Band.
Those second raiders, huh?
Yeah, and then we took the act into Boston for a while. We did some recordings, and then kind of one of the guys moved out to L.A. to pursue the L.A. thing. But ironically, just the last week, we've gotten contacted on some of those old recordings.
Nice.
There's a label called Mexican Summer Records out of Brooklyn. And they wanted to license some of that music for film and TV. Go figure.
Wow.
20 years after the fact. So,
20 years to become an overnight success.
Yeah. Now we got to remix and master the stuff because it's pretty bad. The mixing, back then, it was kind of lo-fi.
Good for you. Yeah. What about you, Bill? I know that he just kind of gave you that little introduction there, but why don't you expand on that a little bit and tell the folks a little about you.
I played piano for a little while, then bass.
Yeah.
And then went to the guitar. And harmonica was always in there, in and out. Mm-hmm. But I really took to the harmonica. I really loved that, you know, because you can take it anywhere.
Right, right.
And you just show it to a band. The band's playing, you just show it to them, and you actually on stage.
Nice.
Key West, forget it. It's great.
Nice.
You know what I mean? New Orleans and all that.
Cool. Yeah. Now, did you come up in the same circuit? You guys played together, many years. Mm-hmm. But did you come up around the same circuit, play the same places?
No.
Where'd you cut your teeth?
I was Bridgewater, Brockton, Easton. Mm-hmm. That I played with a band called Synergy, and Smooth Move.
Mm-hmm. Dale and the Duds.
Yeah, I played with Dale and the Duds.
Dale and the Duds. I must have seen you. I remember that band.
Yeah. Oh yeah. They're still doing it.
I bet. Yeah.
They're still doing it.
Cool. Now, when you guys got together, when you put the ad out there, how many people did you go through before you found?
I went through like five wacky singers.
Really?
Yeah. And Ian came in, and you just learned the mandolin, didn't you? Didn't you come in?
I didn't know how to play it. No.
You didn't know how to play it, and he came in with a mandolin.
Uh-huh.
And it sounded great,
you
know, and he sang, and he was singing on key. And I was like, wow, that's cool.
Mm-hmm.
And he liked the same, but he liked fishing.
That's what it came down to.
So I was just like, that's great. And then hunting and fishing and, out together.
How easy was it for you to mesh musically, though? Was it something that
was
natural?
It was
you just eased into it?
Yeah, like Del Fuego's. I remember.
They're a band.
Don't Run Wild.
Sure.
I started strumming that. He was right into it.
Really?
And I go, oh, man, you can't find that. You know what I mean?
Right. Oh, geez, I'm blushing. Actually, maybe that's the booze.
No, we just got the same. You know, I'm a little more bluesy than he is. He's a little more.
I like the alternative rock, punk stuff.
Yeah.
Well, if you remember him from the last time on the show, a little Daughtry move and a little, he was busting the moves.
I'm known for that sometimes.
Exactly, and you do it well, by the way.
Thank you.
Don't get too close to him.
I know. With the hands flailing, the guitar flailing.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, how would you describe or classify your music?
Acoustic rock.
Acoustic rock.
Yeah.
And talk about some of the music that you play. So, how much of a blend of, let's say, originals versus cover that you do?
Can I take that one to start?
Yeah, do it.
Go for it.
Well, we started off doing covers just because there's so many, it's tough to write good songs right away. And and you got to kind of discover where your influences are.
And you need to get an audience too. I mean, people, a lot of people don't go off the back to, you know, off the bat to see originals.
Yeah, and we found ourselves kind of arranging, you know, songs our own way because of what we do with the vocal harmonies and the mandolin and the harmonica. And the more we did that, the more we found there wasn't really. We ended up getting toward Everly Brothers and some of that kind of sound, you know, with the close harmonies, and then just deciding that, you know, hey, we should write some songs that kind of fit in with what we do. So it kind of happened kind of organically. You know, we went from doing the covers, and we still do them. We still like doing covers, but we try to, you know, interpret them, keep a style, and that kind of helped us, you know, on the path to writing our own songs. And you know,
what I do like that we do is like we capo a lot and strange tuning, and you know, always changing it up from the way it really is. Mm-hmm. People pick up on that quick,
right? Okay,
you know what I mean, as opposed to just a G, C, and you know what I mean. It's he's always capoing, he's always doing something different, you know, and it makes a nice sound.
Yeah. Now, do you guys plan to remain a duo? Or, you know, do you have aspirations in the future?
Maybe to
add some other people along the way?
We do add drummers and bass players now and then.
Yeah,
we have to for bigger gigs.
Right.
You know what I mean? Weddings and whatnot.
Our first release was in 2016, and we had a full band for that. We brought in a real good drummer, PJ Drennan, local guy who's an excellent drummer.
Yep.
I ended up playing the bass, tracking the bass. But when we play, you know, like Bill said, bigger places, we like to have a band. We have another, we're going to the studio, I think, at the end of this month, we're going to Ultrasound with Joe Clapp, who did a record with a band I was in called Ecstatic a while back, and he's a real good local producer.
Yep.
He's done some big stuff, and so we're going to go in there, and we'll probably bring in a drummer for that and a bass player.
Yeah, he's done some producing for some other guests on my show. I think he did Sharon Wendy Robertson, I think.
Yes, I've heard the new one. That's fantastic.
Yeah, he did with Sharon, and I think he's done some others. I'm not sure about Eileen Springer, but I know that he's had some people that he really does quality work.
He's got great ears, and you go in there thinking one thing, and he'll suggest something, and it turns out to be the perfect idea.
Yeah.
Those ears, you can't use that with a knob. You know?
Right.
Right.
Now, how would you say that your music has evolved over the years? I know you've been along for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm sure that you have your peaks and your valleys, but what would you say, you know, where your evolution is, you know, where you've come, let's say, over the last couple of years, and maybe where do you want to go from here? How do you see your music progressing?
The music, it speaks for itself. If we start strumming something out and it sounds good, we'll work on it.
Okay.
And a lot of times we'll strum something out and it's just not clicking.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Any song can be played, but people will pick up on if it's played right.
Okay.
You know what I mean? If it's just a little off, it's just, if we're trying too hard, you know, you see musicians try too hard all the time.
Right, right.
It's like, you know, we don't have a set list.
Mm-hmm.
We just go out, we play, and, you know, it's just, the music takes care of itself, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
Do you find yourself with any kind of influences in your music, either conscious or unconscious, from people that you might have grown up with, or people that you might say, I wish I could play like this guy, or blow the harp like this guy, or play the bass like this guy?
Sure.
Do you find those things happening, and who would some of those people be?
Oof.
Well, for me, guitar-wise, it's Pete Townsend.
Pete Townsend, yeah.
Yeah, it's always been, and Keith Richards.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not the most fluid lead guitar player, Hans will tell you that. But but I like the rhythm players, guys like that. Ronnie Wood, you know. And then on the punk side of things, you know, like just the way Elvis Costello plays guitar and Joe Strummer from The Clash, these are guys that really like, you know, really, really speak to me. Listen to the Buzzcocks and stuff like
that. So you find that stuff kind of integrating itself into your style or into your music a little bit?
Especially with this hand. Yeah. I really like to play, get the rhythm going with the right hand. You know, Billy Zoom from X is another one of my favorites. Yeah.
Sure. What about you?
Well, like Lester Butler, who's with the Red Devils. I loved his style of playing, and I always try to pick up on that. He only had like 3 or 4 albums, but
that's harmonica, correct?
Yep, that's correct. Harmonica.
Yeah,
and that's always where I kind of geared towards.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that's blues based, so we don't really do much for blues.
Right.
But you know, it's there.
You say, wow, these are great riffs and these are great instrumentals. Let's that's not screw question. It up by putting lyrics to it.
Yeah.
Do you ever find yourself into that quandary where you have to decide whether to keep something as a pure instrumental versus lyric?
Yeah, in GarageBand, I probably got like 20 things that I recorded with him, and go back and listen to me and say, that's really good.
We do have one song that's an instrumental, though. We're going to record it coming up.
Uh-huh.
I can't say the name of it yet because it's, I can't say it, but it's very influenced, I think, by the spaghetti westerns, the Sergio Leone stuff.
Sergio Leone.
It's got this kind of off-kilter vibe to it, but it's instrumental. Which we're excited about doing because
nice.
You know it's You kind of don't get to hear a lot
it's
of instrumentals.
It's got a chromatic harmonic around it.
Yeah,
chromatic. Right. And that's one of the things, that's got a different sound.
Cool.
You know what I mean? From a regular diatonic. Mm-hmm. So I'll, you know, I was like, I love this sound, got to write something with that.
You know? I mentioned diatonic, I could think of that as a Coke, you know, a Diet Coke, you know. Oh, diatonic. Diatonic. Oh, that's said diatonic.
Not, see, tonic is a Boston word. We called it tonic growing up in Boston.
Soda, exactly.
But down on the South Shore with soda.
Exactly.
I would say that's a diatonic.
But I grew up in Hyde Park, you grew up in Roxbury.
Hyde Park.
We call it tonic.
Yeah.
Right? Am I right?
Yeah. Now, what are you going to be playing today? I mean, you started off with that nice kick-ass song.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, once again, I want you to sit back and buckle up because you are going to be hearing The Keepers, and that is Mr. Ian Campbell and Bill Cavanagh. We'll be right back.
Three, four. Alone in the field, it's coming. You're moving much too slow. In the car, in the engine's running. Girl, we got to go. Come back to me. You'll never be the same without you, girl. I feel just like you're already gone. All alone in the field, it's coming. You're moving much too slow. We'll be right back.
drinking with my good friends, drinking non-stop down. Here comes another round. Here comes another round. Drinking with my friends, love to on a weekend. Drinking with my friends, love to on a weekend. Drinking with my friends, love to on a weekend. Drinking with my friends, love to on a weekend.
House Mary, Cocaine Carrie, Rack House Mary, Cocaine Carrie, there's trouble on the way. House Mary, a cocaine carry, there's trouble on the way. They'll play you to the middle, work your fingers to the bone, turn you on your brother, even wreck your happy home. Well, I said a crack house Mary. Cocaine carry, there's trouble on the way. All right, Mr. Bill, come on, man.
Rosemary. Hey, who can carry? Hey, crack house Mary, who can carry this trouble all the way?
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. I told you that you were going to be in for a treat. That was awesome, guys.
Thank you.
That was awesome, I tell you. But as I always tell people, one of the enemies of this show is the clock. So we're going to have to kind of wind it down a little bit. But I think that it's very important for these folks at home to know how they can see your music and get a hold of you or follow you and go out to some of the venues where you play. So take it away. Talk about some of the places where you play and how people can see you.
The Fisherman's View on the canal, that's one of our good ones. The BBC.
The BBC. And
these are all kind of South Shore gigs, right?
Yeah,
all
absolutely.
Kind of South Shore
it's
places.
It's all near the water because it's all about fishing.
But you can go to the website, which is www.keeperstheband.com.
That's going to be up there.
So we post all the gigs are on there, and then there's also some reviews and some videos.
We'll be packing the house wherever you come.
We like that idea.
Yeah. And, you know, ladies and gentlemen, as I always say, it is very important that you go out and support your local musicians. Not only these guys, but go to the different clubs, go to the different venues. How many jams, how many great places are there to go and play? You can go to Peach, you can go to the next page, you go to Players. You know, you can go to many different jams, and it costs you nothing more sometimes than a beer and a pizza, and you walk out of there with an ear full of great music. So as always, support your local musicians. Yeah. And also, I want to thank a studio guest person today. We have Mr. Hannes Schneider in the house. He has been offering his support. And also, our esteemed director, Roxanne Morris, is off doing one of her acting gigs. And she has been admirably replaced, say that 10 times fast, by Mr. Dave Young, the access coordinator here, who did a great job.
He was awesome.
Sound. So, Dave, we want to thank you for that. So, Ian, thank you so much.
It was a blast.
Thank you so much. Yeah. I appreciate
it.
Thank you. So, for Ian and Bill, Dave Young, and everybody here at SMAC, I am Frank Walsh. Tune in and tune on.
Thank you, everybody at home.